Hello. So far, we have seen a technique called diagonalization to prove that certain problems are not decidable, or in terms of languages, certain languages are not recursive. So today, in this lecture, we will look at yet another technique called reductions to have some other undecidability proofs. Okay. Of course, we cannot use reductions until we have at least a few examples, at least one example of an undecidable problem ready with us. But thanks to diagonalization, we already have the halting problem, which we can use for the purposes of reduction. Okay, so let us see how a reduction works. But before doing that, let me just have a small recapitulation of what we have done earlier. So we have seen the technique of diagonalization, which works like this. First of all, we have defined a couple of very important languages based upon our ability to encode a Turing machine M as a string over 0,1, and also some input W or X, whatever you call. This can also be encoded over as a string over 0,1. Okay. And this is not just encoding. Any other Turing machine can easily decode such encoded machines and encoded inputs. Okay. So it can be done by a Turing machine. So given any encoding of M and W, which are understandable by other Turing machines, which can be decoded by other Turing machines, we had shown the recursive enumerability of two problems. So this is one. The first one is, these are actually not mentioned in terms of problems, but these are essentially languages. The set of all M hash W, where M is a Turing machine. Actually, it is the encoding of a Turing machine, and W is the encoding of an input. So this is actually using some kind of abusive notation. So M basically means a Turing machine, and also an encoding of a Turing machine. This is just an abuse of notation. Depending upon the context, it will be clear whether you are talking about the machine or its encoding. Likewise for a W. Okay, so whether we are talking about some string or an encoding of that string, depending upon the context, we can get a meaning of this. So I will use same M to denote a machine as well as its encoding. Okay. So we have defined. So here, for example, this stands for the encoding M hash W. This is the encoding of a Turing machine M. This is the encoding of an input for M. And here, actually, we are talking about the machine and the actual input. So this is the problem, membership problem. So this is the membership problem. Given M and W, decide whether M accepts W. And this is the halting problem. Given M and W, decide whether M halts on input W by either accepting or by explicitly rejecting. Okay. Yeah, Yeah, so this is just a recapitulation of the definition. A total Turing machine, okay, which you also call a decider. It holds on all inputs, irrespective of whether it is accepted or rejected. Every rejection is an explicit rejection by going to the state R. Okay. And we will interchangeably use the terms decider and total Turing machine. Okay. We have also seen that both these problems are Turing recognizable, but we have actually, I would say, designed what is called, this is called the universal Turing machine, U, that decides, that's, I would say, that recognizes the membership problem. And the halting problem is another kind of universal Turing machine. You may call it U prime, or if you want to make it more, I would say, more explicit, you may just call it the universal Turing machine corresponding to the membership problem, universal Turing machine corresponding to the halting problem. And these machines, they are both blind simulators. Okay. And the capability of a simulation machine, simulating machine like U or U prime, UMP or UHP, establishes that both these languages are Turing recognizable or recursively enumerable. And then, using a diagonalization argument, we have established that the halting problem is non-recursive. In terms of this language, this is non-recursive, or in terms of the problem, this is undecidable. Okay. We have not yet established whether MP is recursive or not. We will see it very soon. So, the fact that HP is non-recursive implies that no decider can exist for solving the halting problem, no matter how intelligent Turing machines are. So, just blind simulation is, I would not say the best possible idea, but in general, by looking at the code of the machine and some input, there is no general technique using which a Turing machine can decide in finite amount of time for all instances of M and W whether M is going to halt on W. Okay. Blind simulation is a way. There may be more intelligent simulations which may solve this problem for certain instances of M and W, but there cannot exist a general purpose, I would say, in a sense, algorithm that will decide this, that will decide this problem. Okay. Maybe instead of blind simulation, you do some kind of intelligent reviewing of the encoding of the transitions of M and other things. And on some instances, even without running the simulation, you may decide whether M is going to halt on W or not. But in general, this is not a problem that can be decided. Okay. Although it can be recognized. And this recognition of this language by a Turing machine can be established by just blind simulation. Okay. Both MP and HP. Okay. By blind simulation, we can just say whether this is Turing recognizable or this is Turing recognizable. We can say those things. But deciding those things, okay, that is by designing a total Turing machine to accept this or this language is not possible, which we have established using a diagonalization procedure for the halting problem. Okay, and we have also seen that a similar diagonalization technique works for the membership problem also, And that also establishes that this MP is also undecidable or non-recursive. But in a few minutes, we will propose another way of establishing this membership problem as non-recursive, given that the halting problem is already proved to be non-recursive. So this is a technique called reduction. And here, the solvability or unsolvability is always relative. That is, given a problem P1 or language P1 and a language P2, you say something about P2 in terms of P1, or you say something about P1 in terms of P2. Okay, so I will formally define reduction soon, but we will start with an intuitive understanding of how a reduction mechanism works. So one of these problems may be the halting problem, the other one may be the membership problem. So I will somehow relate the difficulty of solving the membership problem to the difficulty of solving the halting problem. And this relation will ensure that since the halting problem is impossible to solve in the recursive way, this will also establish that the membership problem is also impossible to solve in the recursive way. Of course, we know that both are solvable in the recursively enumerable way. Okay, so let us see our first example of reduction. So this picture essentially defines, or I would say illustrates, the reduction mechanism that we use in this context. Okay. So, I assume that there is a decider for the membership problem. Okay. So, here I assume that HP is already known to be proved to be non-recursive. Okay. Using this fact, I will prove that the membership problem is also non-recursive. Okay. So that's the idea. Okay. So this is again a proof by contradiction. So assume that a decider for the membership problem exists. So this is this hypothetical box. Okay. This is a decider for the membership problem. Now what I have to do, this thing I have to design, a reduction algorithm that, given an input m, w or m hash w or m hash x, as we have used in the last lecture, converts that m hash w to an instance n hash v for the membership problem. Okay. So this reduction algorithm is basically another Turing machine which, given M and W as input, produces just this N and V and stops. Okay. So this is the reduction algorithm is yet another Turing machine, or it's a Turing machine. It's not meant for deciding something, but for converting the input M hash W for the halting problem to the input N hash V for the membership problem. Okay. Now, why is this important? Okay. Now, okay, so this comes here. So, whatever I have mentioned, we want to prove the undecidability of the membership problem under the assumption that the halting problem is not decidable. Okay. So, this reduction algorithm, which is again a Turing machine, takes M hash W as input. So, this is an input for the halting problem. and it will generate an input n hash v for the membership problem. Okay. Now, for this reduction algorithm to make sense, there are two things. First, for every instance of M and W, this reduction algorithm, which is again a Turing machine, must halt after a finite amount of time. Okay, and the effect is n hash w, n hash v written in its step. Okay, so this is the first requirement. The reduction algorithm has to be the work of a total Turing machine. Okay, it is not that it succeeds for some instances and it does not succeed, it keeps on looping for some inputs m and w. That should not be the case. Whatever the input m and w supplied to the reduction algorithm, it will stop after producing n and v. So this is very important, that this must be not just a Turing machine, it has to be a total Turing machine. Okay, this is the first, I would say, requirement for a reduction algorithm. And an equally important requirement for this reduction algorithm is that this statement, n accepts v if and only if m halts on w. Okay, if that is the case, then you see that this reduction followed by this hypothetical decider, okay, for the membership problem, this gives me this outer dotted box, which is essentially a decider for the halting problem. Okay, so this decider says yes or no, and simply say whatever this says. Now, if n actually accepts v, then this hypothetical decider will say yes, and this will imply m halts on w. Okay. On the other hand, if v is not accepted by n, that is, it is either explicitly rejected or rejected by looping, then this decider will say no. And then once again, by this if and only if condition, this means m does not halt on w. Okay. So this reduction algorithm, in tandem with this hypothetical decider for this mp, together it will be a decider for the halting problem. Okay. But we know that this dotted box is impossible to construct, and this we have proved using diagonalization. Okay. But what is the assumption here? If I can have a reduction algorithm that satisfies these two quantities, succeeds on all inputs, and it has this behavior, n accepts v if and only if m halts on w, I will soon establish that such a reduction is possible. Okay. So, if I can have such a reduction, if I can actually construct such a reduction algorithm, then the fact that a decider for HP does not exist will imply that this box cannot exist. Because this is very much real. Given this, I can construct this algorithm. Okay. So, the only assumption that is wrong here is that the decider for MP did exist. This was an assumption. If it exists, then a decider for HP also exists. Okay. Which we have proven using another method is not possible. Okay. So, this is what is written. If MP has a decider D, then the reduction algorithm followed by this decider D decides HP, but we have proved HP is not decidable using diagonalization. So this is a contradiction, and therefore this assumption that MP has a decided T is not true. It has to be false. And we arrived at this contradiction because of this assumption and only this assumption. Okay. So this is how deduction works. Okay. I will make a more formal treatment of reduction after a few slides, but first let us see how this reduction algorithm in this case works. So first note that it should have these two desirable characteristics. One, it has to be the work of a total Turing machine, and second, N accepts V if and only if M holds on W. So now let us look at this reduction algorithm. Okay. So as the last picture says, the input to this reduction algorithm is M and W, and output from this reduction algorithm is N and V. Okay. So the input is M and W, the output is N and V. Okay. And let us see how this works. So I will give you a brief idea. And then I will formally show you this thing. So M has two states. This is M. This is the accept state T. This is the accept state R. Okay. Whenever, this is machine M. Okay. Whenever M reaches T on input W, so W is supplied as an input. Okay, whenever M reaches T, it explicitly accepts. Okay, so accept and hold. Whereas, if M upon input W ever goes to this state, then basically it means reject and hold. Okay, there is a third case, M loops on W. Okay, so these are two halting configurations, and this is looping configuration. So N, on the other hand, will basically be the same as M. Okay, it accepts the same input W. So we will soon see that V is equal to W. Now, you will no longer mark this T and R as, okay, as I would say, the accept states. Instead, I will create a new accept state. I will call it T prime. I will create a new reject state. I call it R prime. So, whenever this M reaches this state T, okay, it makes some kind of an epsilon jump. Of course, it's not exactly an epsilon jump. We do not talk about epsilon jumps in connection with the Turing machine, but it's something of that sort. Immediately after reaches T, M reaches T, it goes to T prime. And the same thing happens here. Immediately after M reaches R, in the next state, it makes a jump to state T prime. And there is apparently no way to enter the state R prime. If I wrap the description of M with only these new features, this gives me my N. And the input is basically the same. So I will just write it outside. Okay, W equal to V. Okay. So, if I just wrap M with this additional descriptions, introduction of a new accept state, introduction of a new reject state, marking this old T and R as non-accepting or non-rejecting. Okay, so if I can convert the description of M to the description of this new machine, then you see that this new machine N holds if and only if M either reaches the state T or the state R. But these two are precisely the halting conditions for M. Okay. So if M ever reaches T, then N will accept. If M ever reaches R, then also N will accept. On the other hand, if M loops on N, it will reach neither state T or state R. So N will also never reach T prime or R prime, because these are the only input arcs we give to T prime, and there are no input arcs coming to R prime. So this is how the reduction works. Okay. So whatever language I have used, whatever encoding scheme I use for M, you convince yourself that changing the encoding of M to the changing of the new encoding of N is fairly straightforward and can be done by a total Turing machine. Okay. And of course, in this context, I will simply take V equal to W. Okay. So this is how the reduction works. Let us see the formal statements. Okay. So as I mentioned, to whatever the description of M is, add a new accept state T prime and a new reject state R prime to the set of states of M. So if M contains something like small n number of states, replace that number of states by n plus 2. Okay. Then, mark the old accept and reject state T and R of M as non-halting, which essentially means there was somewhere in the encoding which said that T is the accept state, R is the reject state for M. Now for the output machine, you just replace that t 0 power t by 0 power t prime and replace that 0 power r by 0 power r prime. Okay. And then you have to add the transitions. If the original machine ever reached t, then whatever you read, go to t prime, move r, move right. Okay. Keep it as it is. Likewise, whenever the old machine reaches R, whatever it reads, move right, go to state T prime. And do not include any input transition to the new reject state R prime. Okay. And take just V equal to W. Okay. So such small changes in the encoding of M to an encoding of N can be easily done. Okay, so it can be done by a total Turing machine. And it's not really very difficult to see how. Okay, you may actually try to do it. And it's a fairly straightforward conversion from one input to another input. Okay. So, since no transitions into R prime are added, N always rejects by looping, and therefore, So this is the first thing. This can be done by a total Turing machine. So this condition is satisfied. And the second requirement is that M holds after accepting in state T or rejecting in state R. Then N runs just one more step, that is this transition, these or this, to jump to T prime and accept. And therefore, the second requirement, if M loops on W, N also loops. And so, M holds on W if and only if N accepts V. Okay, so that is the second requirement that must be present in the reduction algorithm. Okay, must be satisfied by the reduction algorithm. So, first one is a total Turing machine can do it. And secondly, this is the vital thing. Behaviorally, M, the decision of halting of M on W is exactly same as the decision of acceptance of n, acceptance of v by n. Okay, and this reduction algorithm satisfies that, and this shows that since the halting problem is undecidable, the acceptance or the membership problem, that is also undecidable. This is how reduction works. So I will give you a more formal way of talking about reductions very soon. So this example illustrates that this is an important thing. From which problem to which problem you are making the reduction. So that is the direction of reduction. Okay. So recall that we had a reduction from HP to MP. Okay. So this is already known to be undecidable. And this is a problem that we want to prove to be decidable. Okay. So reduction in the other direction does not actually work. Okay. So formally we will see why, but the basic idea is that you always reduce from a problem which is already known to be undecidable to a problem which we want to prove to be undecidable. So this is the direction. From a known undecidable problem to a new undecidable problem. Okay, it's not the other way around. Okay, so why? So if the direction of reduction went the other way, okay, what does it say? Here I am proposing a valid reduction from in the other direction. So from a new problem to a known undecidable problem. So let's see. Such kind of reduction is also fairly straightforward. Why? So the input is MP. So once again, let us draw this box. Okay. So you have a reduction algorithm. Okay. So this is the reduction to halting problem. So it's a decider for HP, and I want to generate a decider for MP. So you take an input for the membership problem. So this is reduction. So now M hash W, this is an input for the membership problem, okay. And you want to convert it to an input N hash V for the halting problem. How will it work? So it is fairly straightforward. What would it would satisfy? M accepts W if and only if N halts on V. Okay. So let us see this reduction. M accepts W if and only if N halts on V. So this should be a primary thing that must be satisfied by the reduction engine, and also this reduction has to be done by a total Turing machine. So now let us see how this can be done. Okay, so the idea is if M accepts, N will also accept. Okay, but if M rejects, N should loop. Okay, so that means if M rejects by explicitly entering the state R, N will not immediately reject, because that is once again a situation where N should observe looping behavior. Okay, so the idea is create a new reject state R prime for N, and this R prime is the explicit reject state for n, but I will add no transition into R prime. Okay. So whenever this machine M enters the old reject state, it is now no longer a reject state. Okay. But I will add, for example, a forced looping. Okay. You stay in the state R, do not explicitly reject, but keep on looping. And there is no way you can enter R prime to reject explicitly. So all rejection of N is via looping. Okay. Irrespective of whether M rejects explicitly by going to this state R or by looping. If M loops, N will also loop. If M enters R, then N will loop in the state R. Okay. So that's the idea. Okay. And as usual, take V equal to W. Okay. So no transition into R prime. Therefore, M accepts W if and only if N halts on V. Okay. So, this is definitely a valid reduction from MP to HP, but given the undecidability of the halting problem, this says nothing about the undecidability of the membership problem. This only says this is a way to solve the membership problem. Not a problem, but the, I would say, idea behind this reduction is that this is not an undecidability proof for MP, because you have something like this. This is a reduction. Then if you have something to solve the halting problem, this gives you a way to solve the membership problem. Okay, so this reduction gives it one way of solving the membership problem, but this reduction does not say anything about that. This reduction is the only way of solving the membership problem. It may have other ways of solving without using this reduction. Okay, so a decider for MP must not be forced to use a hypothetical decider for HP, and therefore this is a reduction went in the wrong direction. Okay. However, if it was proved that the membership problem was undecidable, then this reduction shows that the halting problem is also undecidable. But we have started with proving this as undecidable, and then we have proved this to be undecidable. If we started with this, this reduction works to prove that this problem is undecidable. It's not the other way around. Okay. So this is a very important thing about reduction. Okay. To prove undecidability or non-recursiveness of languages. Okay. So now let us look at the formal definition of reduction. So suppose that A is a language over sigma and B is a language over, let's say, this is gamma. Okay. So A is a language over sigma and B is a language over another alphabet. Maybe gamma. Okay. So this means A is a subset of sigma star, B is a subset of gamma star. Okay. Now, okay, so let this be languages. Okay. Now consider a map which is pictorially shown here from sigma star to gamma star. It's not a map from A to B, but from the entire sigma star to this gamma star. Okay. Such that if I take anything like this here, Then I apply the map, I will reach inside B. And if I take anything outside this A and apply the map, I will go somewhere outside this language B. Okay. So, in a sense, this sigma map preserves the membership in A and the membership in B. So, if W is in A, if it is something like these or these or these or this, its image will be inside this language B. Okay. And if W is not in A, that is in sigma star minus A, then its image will also be outside B. Okay. So, for example, this A may be an instance, a set of all instances, accept instances for the halting problem. B could be the accept of all instances of the halting problem. Okay. And there are certain requirements. So, first of all, sigma need not be injective. Okay, this is a very important thing. It need not be injective as long as this membership, membership information is preserved by this map. Different things may map to the same thing. Here also different things may map to the same language. That's perfectly fine. Okay. And this map must be implementable by a Turing machine, R. So this is called the reduction engine, or the reduction machine. So not only that, R is a Turing machine, it must be a total Turing machine. So in other words, this is the behavior of this reduction engine on every input W. Okay, for this language A, okay, for every input W in sigma star, the TM computes the image sigma of W, which is an element of this gamma star. Okay, for every input, the TM must halt after correctly computing this map, reduction map, sigma W. Okay. So in that sense, R is a total Turing machine. It never fails. Okay, it correctly computes and does so in a finite amount of time. Okay. So, R is a reduction algorithm. Okay, it's basically a Turing machine. But anyway, we'll call it R, a reduction algorithm, a reduction agent, or a reduction mechanism, or simply a reduction. Okay. So essentially, it implements the map sigma. Okay. And we also, these are also some other terms. Sigma is a reduction from A to B. And we also use this notation, A reduces to B. And this M often we use to highlight that this is not a one-to-one reduction, it's a many-to-one reduction. It need not be a one-to-one reduction, it's a many-to-one reduction. But when this notion of reduction is, evident from the context, we can simply say A reduces to B. Okay. Because there are other notions of reduction. And in order to highlight, we are talking about a many-to-one reduction. Okay. We write M. But throughout the rest of this course, we will only talk about reductions of this type. And therefore, it is safe to avoid this subscript M and simply write this reduction as A reduces to B. Of course, why is this less than equal to sign? The idea is that if I can reduce A to B, then this reduction followed by a solver for B gives us a way to solve A. Right. So, the membership problem of A is no more difficult than the membership problem for B. Why? Because of course, if I can solve this membership problem for B, I can solve this membership problem for A because I have a reduction engine. Okay. So I convert an instance for this membership problem of A to an instance for the membership problem of B, and because inside A things go to inside B, outside A go to outside B. So using this, I solve A. But the idea is that this is not necessarily the only or even the most efficient way of solving A. Okay. A may have some other ways of solving. This is just one way. And therefore, the actual difficulty of A cannot be larger than the difficulty of solving B. And that is captured by this less than equal to sign. A is no more difficult than B. Okay. What is A? Of course, A means the membership problem for A is no more difficult than the membership problem for B. And that justifies the less than equal to sign. Okay. And we have already seen a couple of examples. We have seen the halting problem reduces to the membership problem, and the membership problem reduces to the halting problem. Okay. So we will see a few other examples. In fact, many other examples of this reduction. Okay. So, but before doing so, it's timely to have some caution about reduction. First of all, whenever we talk about languages, we are talking about recursive, recursively enumerable, and all that stuff. Okay. But any language L can be rephrased as a membership problem. For example, given W in sigma star, decide whether W is in L or not. So in that sense, languages have one-to-one correspondence with problems. Okay, this is how we have defined problems. Languages and problems are the same. So instead of reduction from one language to another, we can also talk about reduction of one problem to another. Where by problem, we usually mean the membership problem for that language. Okay. So even when we talk about problems, we can use this notation, P less than equal to Q, when P and Q are problems, not necessarily languages. Okay. So the reduction algorithm is supposed to convert an instance of P to an instance of Q, such that P has the answer yes, if and only if Q has the answer yes on the instances. Okay. And this is very, very important. A reduction algorithm makes no effort to solve either P or Q. The only task of the reduction algorithm is to convert an instance of P or a member of P, if this is a language, or an instance of P, if this is a problem, to an instance of Q, if Q is a problem, or to a member of Q, if Q is a language. Okay. That is the only duty of the reduction algorithm. The reduction algorithm solves neither P nor Q. It is only an instance converter. This must be kept in mind. Okay. It makes no effort to solve either P or Q. Okay. So, given this, we have now a couple of uses of reduction. Okay. So if Q is solvable, then the reduction algorithm followed by this solver for Q gives us one way of solving P. Okay. Therefore, if Q is solvable, we can use this solver as a subroutine to solve P. But as I mentioned, this need not be the only way of solving P, but this is definitely one way of solving P. But since we have one way to solve P, we can say that if Q is solvable, then P is also solvable. Right? Okay. So, if Q is solvable, then P is solvable. Because this reduction gives us a way to solve P given a solver for Q. Okay. And the contraposition of this statement is that if P has no solver, okay, so A implies B, the contraposition is that not of B implies not of A. So it says that if P does not have a solver, then Q also cannot have a solver. Okay, so if no solver for P exists, then no solver for Q can exist. Okay, so this is this type of arguments we will use in all reduction proofs. Okay, for undecidability. Okay, in this and a few other future lectures, we will essentially talk about undecidability. Actually, we will talk about something little bit more than undecidability. We will also talk about what is called unsemi-decidability. So, reduction proofs will essentially establish impossibility of doing certain things. So, we will use it in this setting. We'll assume, we'll first prove that no solver for P exists. And by a reduction from this problem to a new problem, we will prove that no solver for Q can exist. And we will later see that the solver can be a decider. It can even be a semi-decider. Okay. This will be used to prove the undecidability. Okay. Of certain problems, that is non-recursiveness of certain languages, whereas semi-decidability has to do with recursive enumerability. So whenever I start from something which is not even Turing recognizable, that is recursively enumerable, such a reduction will show that Q is also not only not decidable, it is not even semi-decidable. That is, the corresponding language is not even Turing recognizable. Okay, so in the next and a few other following lectures, we will concentrate on such reductions to prove undecidability or even unsemi-decidability. I think we can stop at this point because it's already almost 1 hour. So we will look at other examples, many other examples of such reduction proofs in the next few lectures. Okay, so with this, I stop this session. See you once again in the next lecture. Bye.